Satan Unbound. Is it possible that we're living during the times where Satan is loosed to deceive the nations? Having at least 1,000 years after being bound by God to perfectly perfect and craft his plan to deceive all of humanity besides a select few chosen by God. In this film, we will be diving headfirst into the rabbit hole, exploring certain topics that little to no one is willing to talk about, or even knows about. And some of these topics will be projected in a different light that you most likely haven't heard before. Taking a closer look at what was really encoded in Shakespeare's work, Fabricated History, ancient Egypt in the pyramids, the Rosicrucians, mystery religions, etc. Before we start, to tie all this together, we're gonna take a look at some scripture. Now wait, I know that's some of y'all's cue to click off, but hear me out. To those who don't believe, most of y'all see the Bible as a book of sacred numbers, or a book describing astrology, or for the more advanced, a true anatomy book describing the things in our brain and laying out how they work. And yes, all that stuff can be found in the Bible, but where y'all go wrong is y'all think it's either A, B, C, or D. It's not A, B, C, or D, it's all of the above. So when we say the Bible, most people automatically assume the notion we're talking about the KJV or some of the new sketchy versions. And many of us believers are well aware that the KJV may or may not have had its final occultic Rosicrucian encoded type edits by Francis Bacon before its finalization. So please, don't try and generalize us and attack us as if we're all just some type of KJV only cult. And no offense to any KJV only readers, I'm not saying any of those claims are 100% true, but it's just something you may want to look into and come to your own conclusion. That being said, the scriptures are inspired by the Holy Spirit of God, and all that extra stuff are just layers of his handiwork. You see, God is not bound by time, and there are things in the Bible that we are just beginning to truly understand, because God is willing to reveal them to those with eyes to see. But remember, none of that extra stuff matters if you choose to deny the immovable structure of truth set before the foundation of the world, which is in his Son Jesus Christ. Because when you do that, you start to see the more laughable theories, such as Jesus was a mushroom, or Jesus was a collective hallucination, or even worse, when they try and use falsified history to make theories such as he was the Egyptian kundalini liquid that rises up your spine and to your pineal gland. Or the just as bad when they try and use the history that they tell us happened in the first century around 70 AD and make the theories like, oh, Jesus was just a Roman creation by Tacitus, Titus, and Nero and Josephus and them, without realizing that the chronology of the history they give us has been so heavily fabricated and rewritten, it's hard to tell if some of these historical plants even truly existed. And if they did, often not during the dates they give us. For a quick example, let's take a brief look at around 70 AD, Pompeii. What do we really know about Pompeii? According to the official historical narrative, in 79 AD, the ancient Roman city of Pompeii was completely buried under 13 to 20 feet of volcanic ash from the eruption of Mount Vesuvius. The ancient site was lost and abandoned, and their names and locations were forgotten. Pompeii was eventually finally rediscovered and excavated in 1748 by Spanish military engineer Roque Joaquin. But what if that narrative wasn't true at all? There actually seems to be a lot wrong with this mainstream narrative, and there's a lot of evidence pointing towards the destruction of Pompeii being a lot more recent than they tell us. Let's examine a few of these evidences. In 1514, Ambrogio Leone published the book Denola, containing Pompeii on a map still standing as a populated city. In 1570, Abraham Ortelius published the Regni Neapolitani, again showing Pompeii as an active city. In 1575, Antonio Laferri published the map of Italy, clearly depicting Pompeii well in standing, even showing cathedrals. In 1603, Philip Kluver published a map of Italy, showing Pompeii still not destroyed, but as a populated city. Besides the maps, we then have Mascalo's record of 1633. Giovanni Battista Mascalo lived from 1582 to 1656 and actually claimed to have witnessed the eruption of Mount Vesuvius and the true destruction of Pompeii. Not in 79 AD, but in 1631. He then drew a before and after sketch of what the cities look like. He then claims in his book, two of these fire flows were very quick. One of them vigorously ran down to Herculaneum. The other one ran to Pompeii. Another evidence of the supposed corruption of the historical event could be found in the excavated paintings that seem to be depicting pineapples. The significantly strange thing about this is that it was not possible for there to be pineapples in the first century Europe, which is when they claimed these paintings were drawn. Because according to the mainstream narrative, pineapples are indigenous to South America, only being brought to Europe in the 1500s, meaning the painters would have had no idea about pineapples if they truly lived during that time. However, critics would debate that these are not pineapples, but are pine cones. That being said, it should be clear that the history of the early centuries of the world that they give us are extremely flip-flopped and fabricated and shouldn't be trusted. Personally, I'd go so far to say that anything they tell us before the Renaissance and the Age of Enlightenment Renaissance era should be taken very cautiously, because from those times is when we start to see a shift of humanity from more Christendom, Jesus-centered time all of a sudden to a more Roman, Greek, and occultic uprising. Dr. Anatoly Fomenko, whom is not just any professor, but the head of the math department in Moscow, Russia, who is well versed in dendrochronology, carbon dating, and world chronology, goes so far to say that all the Roman and Greek statues we see today are fabricated creations during the Renaissance era. He also sums up his theories by saying, almost all history they tell us before the 1600s have been widely falsified to suit the agendas of what we call Satan being unbound. It's no coincidence that when the world was mainly Christianized, the elite called it the Dark Ages and loved to bash it. But when the occultic ancient theological presence starts to become manifest, they praise this period and call it the Enlightenment area, and we'll be getting deeper into this later in the film. But with that being said, within all the fabricated history, Jesus remains stable. We don't need these historical plans that they give us to know that there is power in the name of Jesus Christ. I've even seen shamans use the power of the name Jesus Christ to repel spirits, evil spirits, in the different realms during their ayahuasca ceremonies. Often, the biggest Christ deniers are the ones who never experienced or truly seeked his presence themselves and go off seeking spiritual fulfillment in other places. with all that being said, we'll be going through a few scriptures that seem to be manifesting right before our eyes. Now bear with me through these, because after we get through them and start getting into the meat of the video, you'll see how all this perfectly aligns with everything we see going on in the world today in a way you likely haven't heard before. We'll start off with Revelation 19.
Hallelujah. For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints.
In chapter 19 of Revelation is where a lot of confusion starts to come in, especially when referring to certain denominations. You see, the Bible often uses this figurative, feminine, descriptive type marriage language. And this is often where the distortion of truth starts being fed to us as lies. Let's look at some similar verses to get a better understanding of this language. Ephesians 5, verse 23 and 24 writes, "For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is also the head of the church, he himself being the savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands in everything." Again, we have Revelation 12, verse 5. "And she gave birth to a son, a male child, who will rule all the nations with an iron scepter." Again, Isaiah 54, verse 5. "For your maker is your husband, the Lord of hosts is his name, and your redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. The God of the whole earth, he shall be called." It's pretty clear that the woman symbolizes Israel, or the body of Christ, or spiritual Israel, whom God adopted us through his son. But sometime in the history of Christendom, Satan started showing his presence, making all types of different doctrines, and especially infiltrating the Roman Catholic Church. They don't see it as the believers, but rather they teach that all nuns are mystically betrothed to Jesus in an actual marriage ceremony, where a young woman dresses in white and makes a public vow to the church. And after this public profession, the young woman is told that she has become the bride of Christ and must consecrate herself until death.
I was just consecrated as a bride of Christ. More specifically, I was consecrated as a virgin living in the world.
And to make him a promise of our virginity as a gift back to him. So we become brides of Christ.
Receive this veil by which you are to show that you have been chosen for other women to be dedicated to the service of.
As you can see, totally corrupting a doctrine so simple. And they have a deep history of doing these types of things. When you actually start to research these different popes, you find out they secretly did some of the most wicked things that you could think of. And I'll be doing separate videos on some of these untalked about things that some of these popes did. For example, Cardinal Bonaventure, whom they also call a saint, created a complete parody of the Psalms by changing every time the word Lord or God was mentioned, he changed it to Our Lady. Another way they also inverted the whole bride situation was by placing a Jesus-like hierarchy on the Virgin Mary. The doctrine of the Immaculate Conception, or Sinless Perfect Mary, was proclaimed error-free, or infallible, by Pope Pius IX in the formal proclamation in 1854. We can often see how Satan shows his presence by making slight corruptions that most might not catch. On to Revelation 20.
Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he seized the dragon, that ancient serpent who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years, and threw him into the pit, and shut it, and sealed it over him, so that he might not deceive the nations any longer until 1,000 years were ended. After that, he must be released for a little while. Blessed and holy is the one who shares in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years.
Now, when we look into history, especially around the Dark and Middle Age period, and anything before that, things get really distorted and fabricated. Now, we already know they flip-flop certain years and especially events in the antiquity of the chronologic timeline. But looking back through the echoes of time, we still see certain kingdoms and empires that last unusually long for no apparent good reason. As you can see, most empires and kingdoms in history don't usually last very long. However, out of nowhere, we start to see literal 1,000-year reigns from these different Christian empires. For example, we have the Byzantine Empire, 1,000 years. We have the so-called Dark Ages for 1,000 years. And how conveniently that they call it this. We know the God of this world loves to pervert and invert all things good and call it bad, and all things bad and call it good. And we have the Holy Roman Empire, 1,000 years. We also see these same kingdoms in Africa. For example, the Aksumite Kingdom, 1,000 years. We also have what they tell us are the mythical Christian kingdoms. For example, we have Prester John, the powerful Christian king that everyone knew about and wrote about, and even all types of maps about him, but he just didn't exist. And all this going on around the same era. Basically, at one point, mostly all the nations were under the domain of Jesus, like Revelation said would happen. And we can see by the architecture around the world and the failed attempt to destroy most of it. And again, we're not going to be putting too much emphasis on the specific dates and years, because the people who give us our history, for example, Joseph Scaliger, in the 1500s constructed the accepted chronological timeline, who for some odd reason was known in his time as the Light of the World, had direct contact with certain Rosicrucians. And if you know anything about secret societies, mystery schools, and mystery religions, they love encoding certain numerologies in their works. For example, on their timeline, they put the legalization of Christianity in the year 313, and put the Knights Templar wreckage year in 1313. You can see all types of synchronicities when looking. But to further clear some things up, let's look at the differences between the loved pagan Rome, Satan Unbound, versus the hated holy world, Satan Bound. And I say hated because the occultists and elites of today despise this time period, because that's when the pagan elites of that time started to decline. And when I say occultists of today, I'm talking about the theosophists, Freemasons, Enlightenment thinkers, Gnostics, atheists of scientific rationalismists, the God of Reason believers, the New Agers, etc. Because all of that was contradictory to what was going on during that time. And in reality, those are just lukewarm versions and attempted revivals of those, you know, hardcore pagan Satan unbound cultures. And I'm aware that a lot of the details of that period have been fabricated, such as when it fell, why, who was ruling, etc. And we'll get into that later. But lastly, I can't stress this enough. When I'm talking about the Golden Age, I'm not talking about the Renaissance. Recently, I've seen some videos claiming the Renaissance was like the thriving point of Christendom, and that can't be farther from the truth. Around that time is where the so-called Roman Church starts to actually become Roman again, if you know what I mean. And when pagan statues start becoming present again, and where history starts to become distorted again, and where all the elite were acting like Christians, but they were really occultists, astrologers, and deceivers. I'm mainly referring to the time before that period, where those things were despised, because during that period was basically the start of the fall. Now that that's cleared out the way, back to the era of Satan Unbound. During this period of chaos influenced by powers of darkness, the world was filled with tons of mystery religions and cults, such as the cults of Mithras, Dionysus, Eleusis, Isis, Cybele, along with all the Jewish mysticism and astrology. And it goes on and on. Many of these cultures lost when the millennium came around, if they weren't preserved. And that's because during this millennial kingdom, those mystery cults had to go full subterranean and become even more occult or hidden to survive and avoid any questioning from a Christendom empire. And that's why we see all these secret societies today even so strongly emphasize their secretiveness about what they do behind the scenes. And often the traditions and rituals of the pagans were figuratively baptized by God. A quick example would be the Saturnalian orgies of Rome, which became the coronations or symbolic crownings of Christian kings. Revelation 3 verse 11, Jesus says, "I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have so that no one may seize your crown." Remember guys, reading the Bible in its context is one of the most important things. We have to remember, the Bible was not written to us. It is written for us, but the direct context was to actual people during the first century. So when Jesus says things like, "Some of you standing here will not taste death," or "This generation shall not pass," or "Even those who pierced and crucified me will see my return in the clouds," he's not just leading those first century people's hopes up just for failure. Keeping the Bible in its context while reading, in my opinion, is what separates those who are searching for truth in scripture to those who are searching for their own theological consensus that tickles their ears in the book. But back to what I was saying, yes, we all know that Christmas was pagan in origin, but all those pagan tradition like the trees and all that other stuff wasn't brought back until the 1500s. But to get back on track, when we look at the people who are passionately against this period of Christendom, the so-called Dark Ages, we see people like H.B. Blavatsky. If you don't know who Helena Blavatsky was, she was a well-known 1800s occultist, founder of Theosophy, and mother of the New Age. In her book, The Secret Doctrine, she states, Satan is the only God. And in her book, Isis Unveiled, she heavily opposes this period of Christendom, because in short, when the millennium came around, all the paganism, Gnosticism, etc. fell off, and she, being an extreme Gnostic, thinking Satan is the true savior, felt offended by what was going on during that millennium. Another person we have who strongly opposed this period was Aleister Crowley. If you don't know who Aleister Crowley was, he was probably the most proud and well-known Satanist during the 19th and 20th century, often referring to himself as the B666 and not hesitating ever to talk about his ritual magic, sex magic, etc. In his book, Magical Diaries, he speaks as if he's almost scared of this Christendom-type period coming back. Then we also have people like Manly Palmer Hall. Hall was a 1900s mystic, occultist, Rosicrucian, astrologer, Kabbalist, and his resume just goes on and on forever. But he was well known for his esoteric Bible teachings, and also for his secret teachings of all ages. He's the type of guy that we're often warned about in scripture, when it tells us to be watchful for those that teach strange philosophies, or those whom are deceived by the elemental spirits. For example, when you look into his work, he'll often acknowledge Jesus, but will just make claims that he was just another mystic. Or, we'll talk about the things in scripture, but just word it fancy and twist it in a way that sounds good, but won't lead you to salvation. For example, he'll say something like, a man's life is a constant contest between lower and higher principles, where spiritual powers are centered, and when conquered by lower vibrations will inevitably result in death. Which is just a fancy way of the scriptures telling us that our flesh battles our spirit. And he'll admit that, but he will never tell you to be born again. No. He'll take the Oprah Winfrey approach and tell you, yeah, Jesus is real and everyone knows that there's power in his name, but he's not the only way, because you can save yourself. He states in his book, when you lift up your passion and emotions through altruism and service, the spiritual fire flows upward your spine and creates the five-pointed star, which points and signifies the coming of Christ within yourself. As you can see, an extreme amount of reaching. It's the Oprah Winfrey doctrine. These people will tell you anything but to get born again. And with these mystics, most of their books are channeled, meaning they get guidance, if you will, from different realms of existence through channeling spirits. And not making it any better, this guy was a 33rd degree Freemason. Who knows what he had to do to get that title? He's not someone that you want to put your trust in his belief system. And sadly, many of these so-called spiritual YouTubers believe in this guy's doctrine. And in the 1920s, he was selling his books that he put together for $1,000 a piece. And in today's money, that's about $13,000 a book. So it wasn't just average, everyday people buying his books. It was other elites and fellow Freemasons. And coincidentally, in the 1900s is when we start to see transcendental meditations being pushed and advised to the public by people like Oprah, the Beatles, Katy Perry, and tons of other elites, influencing people to just sit vulnerable and chant different mantras to themselves. And people don't know better, so they do. But besides for the mystics and occultists that degrade this time period of Christendom, we also have people like NASA's favorite plant, Neil deGrasse Tyson. Of course, he attacks this period of time from a more quote-unquote scientifical approach, basically ridiculing the silly Christians for believing biblical cosmology. In episode 1 of 13 of his TV series Cosmos, in short, he basically says, Christians were dumb for 1,000 years, however, in the Renaissance, smart people became manifest. And even in these clips that I'm about to show you from his show, there's just a lot of sketch and fabrications in this narrative, and you can kind of see through the distortion.
The 16th century. Imagine a world before telescopes, when the universe was only what you could see with the naked eye. It was obvious that Earth was motionless. It was obvious that Earth was motionless. And that everything in the heavens, the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, revolved around us.
So far so good, but it only gets worse from here. Neil then proceeds to tell the story about Giordano Bruno and portray him as some type of hero for opposing the church system. But keep in mind, the church system by this point was already, for the most part, infiltrated or corrupt. But as he continues, we'll be tearing apart the whole fabrications of this story.
Natural-born rebel. He longed to bust out of that cramped little universe. Even as a young Dominican monk in Naples, he was a misfit. This was a time when there was no freedom of thought in Italy. But Bruno hungered to know everything about God's creation. He dared to read the books banned by the church. And that was his undoing.
But what Neil doesn't tell you is that Bruno was not just some random innocent guy who was searching for truth in these quote-unquote banned books. He conveniently leaves out the fact that Bruno was a mystic, Gnostic, Hermeticist, Rosicrucian, alchemist, followed the quote-unquote ancient religions of old, worshipped the astral bodies, was a practicing sorcerer, and his resume literally doesn't stop. But the most telling thing about him is that he believed in Jesus' existence, but seeing him no more than a quote-unquote unusually skilled magician. He also publicly disputed Mary's virginity. But the most significant thing about this character and who he was truly working for is the fact that he believed that Satan was destined to be redeemed and saved by God. But all in all, at least he was blatant about his beliefs, because during this Renaissance-ish slash Enlightenment era, many elites in the church were doing the same things as him, but pretending to be under a Christian persona. And besides this narrative of the story that they give us, I wouldn't be surprised if he was actually working with the church on the down low.
In one of them, an ancient Roman, a man dead for more than 1500 years, whispered to him of a universe far greater. One as boundless as his idea of God.
Also, pay close attention to this part, because this amazing, complex sequence is one of the biggest reasons we have our accepted model of the universe today.
Lucretius asked the reader to imagine standing at the edge of the universe and shooting an arrow outward. If the arrow keeps going, then clearly the universe extends beyond what you thought was the edge. But if the arrow doesn't keep going, say it hits a wall, then that wall must lie beyond what you thought was the edge of the universe. Now if you stand on that wall and shoot another arrow, there are only the same two possible outcomes. It either flies forever out into space, or it hits some boundary where you can stand and shoot yet another arrow. Either way, the universe is unbounded. The cosmos must be infinite.
And that's how we came to agree that the world is infinite. But on a more serious note, the debate is over. All we had to do this whole time is imagine shooting an arrow in the universe, and when it hits a random wall in space, stand on it and just imagine shooting another one. Let's see if Bill Nye passes this test of imagination.
The Earth is a closed system. We cannot leave. There's no place to go.
Anyways, back to the clip.
This makes perfect sense to Bruno. The God he worshipped was infinite. So how, he reasoned, could creation be anything less? And then, when he was 30, he had the vision that sealed his fate. In this dream, he awakened to a world enclosed inside a confining bowl of stars. This was the cosmos of Bruno's time.
Okay, so now I'm gonna show you how that whole narrative seemed to be a story full of fabricated distortions. Now, there's endless amounts of reasons that this whole story is strange, but when we look into the so-called ancient Roman Lucretius, everything just gets even more sketchy. Most who follow this channel know by now that history, and especially the timelines and details of antiquity, is just a bunch of lies agreed upon with a little bit of truth and lots of revisions. And often, a big tactic of theirs is to plant made-up historical figures with no real proof of existence in ancient times to tie together pieces of his story to suit the agendas of those in control. And in my opinion, it's clear that the ancient Roman Lucretius character is likely one of those plants. And here's why. First, virtually nothing is known about the life of Lucretius, and there isn't even a confident basis of his birth or death. We virtually know nothing. Second, the only known book titled to him was lost for over 1,000 years, but was conveniently rediscovered during this early Renaissance period. Not making it any better, this book survived virtually intact, and basically giving it away, they tell us it's disputed if he even lived to put the finishing touches on it. And just for your information, this early Renaissance period was notorious with its fascination with classical, ancient Roman, Greek, etc. cultures. They were also notorious for forging ancient statues and fabricating previous histories. So when a book like this conveniently shows up perfectly intact in their hands, it might be something to question. But what makes the whole scenario worse is that it was found by papal secretary Poggio Bracciolini. Not only was Poggio working for the corrupt papal system, but he was a father of Renaissance humanism. If you're not familiar with humanism, in short, it was the revival of the classical, antique, Satan Unbound cultures of old in the early Renaissance. Now, humanism was set up by a small group of elite who claimed to have access to old books. The Renaissance humanism agenda was intended to influence all of society to revive the cultural legacy and philosophy of the classical antiquity. And like I mentioned earlier, this is kind of the start of the fall. Humanism teaches that everything revolves around man, and that man is the center of his own universe. Teaching ideas like to embrace your lustful nature, and to deny a supernatural God. And of course, the more deeper or shallow you get, the more esoteric or regular it may seem. But this was a very significant era of time, and obviously has lots of influence on today's world. It's also where we start to see hidden encodings on quote-unquote Christian art. For example, Michelangelo's famous Creation of Adam painting. People will often show something like this and try and make the claim that they're hiding the reality about Christianity and the symbolism in Christian art. But in reality, it's not Christian art. It's Renaissance humanism occult cryptography. But many of these painters, including Michelangelo, weren't really Christians, but were occultists hiding under the humanist or spiritualist alias. And we can go on about humanism, but to get back on track, Poggio was a scholar, copyist, and a collector of ancient manuscripts. And word on the street, he was known for touching up and editing many important ancient texts. Of course, that last part's only speculation, but it's been a theory that's been going around. But as for Lucretius, I do think his story is off. But the question we'd have to ask is, what would the elite benefit from creating a forgery? Well, actually a lot. All conveniently packaged into Lucretius's book is what would lead to the theory of evolution. We know that's false. What would lead to modern cosmology? We know that's false. And the theory of the three ages. And we definitely know there was never a time of prehistoric men 2.6 million years ago whom used animal remains and sticks to build. All conveniently packaged in this rediscovered book. And Lucretius then goes on to influence Enlightenment thinkers, Quakers, etc. But the strange character we should be focusing on here isn't Lucretius. It actually goes back to Bruno. Not only did Bruno end up being heroized in science, but because he ended up being persecuted, he actually became venerated and deified in the occult, and is now often known in a way as their alchemical martyr. Many of the occultists mentioned earlier in the vid, such as Crowley, Manly Hall, HB, all write highly about him in their work. And that's because Bruno's ideas weren't to be taken in a scientific stance. And that's because in Bruno's mind, he wasn't thinking scientific, he was thinking philosophy. But of course, Tyson's gonna show us the exoteric view. But let's take a look at it in their eyes.
And then when he was 30, he had the vision that sealed his fate. In this dream, he awakened to a world enclosed inside a confining bowl of stars. This was the cosmos of Bruno's time.
Off rip, Bruno has a gnosis vision. And we know that the thriving Christendom era was just a bit before this time period, which is why Tyson says Bruno is trapped in the cosmos of that time, which is an allusion for the demiurge, you know, the false reality. Not the true light, but just an illusion, because the eye is still blinded and you haven't ascended to enlightenment through, you know, altruism and whatnot. But also representing the ego, or the true evil, or as they twisted in their belief, Jehovah.
He experienced a sickening moment of fear, as if the bottom of everything was falling away beneath his feet. But he summoned up his courage.
Then symbolizing him transcending past the demiurge's firmament into what they call the true light from what they call the supreme being. And that's what Unveiling Isis by H.B. Blavatsky is all about. Blavatsky also claims that Bruno had the spark of Prometheus, who basically rebelled from the evil archonic gods in their mythology. It's all very symbolic. And in a sense, Neil deGrasse Tyson is walking us through this esoteric teaching, but at the same time, the atheists have no clue what's going on, and only can see the exoteric. And even though this whole belief system is a satanic deception, the atheists have no clue what they're buying into. And that's perfect for the duality, because they're unifying the opposites. And that's exactly the Baphomet. But what's just as strange is that they decide to use the famous Flammarion engraving for the Gnosis vision. The origin for the artist of it is a mystery, but it was first found in a man named Camille Flammarion's book in 1888. He did psychic research and was interested in reincarnation and stuff of that sort. But this artwork isn't as innocent as it seems. It's likely to have come from a Rosicrucian or someone affiliated with the occult, because when split and mirrored, it displays something kind of disturbing. It seems to depict an owl. Maybe it's Moloch, or as they would say esoterically, it's Minerva, and we just don't understand the spiritual essence of sacrifices. But before Neil deGrasse Tyson's cosmos was Carl Sagan. But before we get into his anti-Christendom episode, here's his quick overview. Sagan's son said his dad believed in the God of Einstein and Spinoza. Einstein believed in the God of Spinoza, and many, including Blavatsky, tie Spinoza back to Bruno as inspiration. But instead of Bruno being the hero on Sagan's series, they chose Hypatia. Let's take a look at who Hypatia was in their worldview. The Hypatia of the occult was an immortal virgin, goddess of the mysteries. Now, of course, virgin in their sense means a completely different thing, but we'll get to that later. She was also the greatest woman initiate who quote-unquote eclipsed Christianity. Both Manly Hall and Blavatsky using that term eclipsed, portraying her as a lunar moon goddess eclipsing the so-called demiurgic Christianity view. She was also a personal disciple of Greek magician Plutarch, and apparently she also taught the highest philosophical doctrines and unveiled the mysteries of Plato and Plotinus. Do keep in mind that none of her work actually survived, and we know by now that the events in antiquity were heavily fabricated during the Renaissance. So believe this story if you want, but it's probably been rewritten, if it even happened, how they say. So that being said, onto the exoteric Hypatia. Hypatia, according to Sagan, was the last scientist at Alexandria. She was a symbol of science and learning, and was a great beauty, with many suitors, but wasn't interested in marriage. Here's a quick decode of his episode.
Greek kings of Egypt who followed Alexander had at least this virtue. They supported the advancement of knowledge.
Off rip, just as he says advancement of knowledge, we have the Masonic floor, pillars, and ladder, just as the entered apprentice degree.
Let me tell you about the end. It's a story about the last scientist to work in this place, a mathematician, astronomer, physicist, and head of the school of Neoplatonic philosophy in Alexandria. That's an extraordinary range of accomplishments for any individual in any age. Her name was Hypatia. She was born in this city in the year 370 AD. This was a time when women had essentially no options. They were considered property. Nevertheless, Hypatia was able to move freely, unselfconsciously, through traditional male domains. By all accounts, she was a great beauty. And although she had many suitors, she had no interest in marriage.
So she was definitely getting around. But at the same time, in the esoteric view, she was still a virgin, independent from the bondage of Saturn's rings in their belief. So she might have got passed around, but that's okay because some way in their lustly beliefs, she's still a virgin for hidden truths according to the esoteric mysteries. And if you're not initiated into the mysteries and don't have that Christ consciousness, you just won't understand.
The Alexandria of Hypatia's time, by then long under Roman rule, was a city in grave conflict. Slavery, the cancer of the ancient world, had sapped classical civilization of its vitality. The growing Christian church was consolidating its power and attempting to eradicate pagan influence and culture. Hypatia stood at the focus, at the epicenter of mighty social forces. Cyril, the bishop of Alexandria, despised her, in part because of her close friendship with a Roman governor, but also because she symbolized, she was a symbol of learning and science, which were largely identified by the early church with paganism. In great personal danger, Hypatia continued to teach and to publish until...
So she was literally an allusion to Isis Unveiled, because she was a woman unveiling the so-called mysteries hidden by the so-called Saturnian demiurgic government at the time. HB would see her spiritually aligned with the supreme being in the material world, so in their false reality, she'd be a divine union of the above and the below, just like the High Priestess card. And on top of that, Blavatsky says if Hypatia was never persecuted, then all throughout the Dark Ages, everyone would have embraced heliocentrism, and the world would have been just a bunch of quote-unquote enlightened beings. So, in esoteric teachings, both Sagan and Neil can be seen as hierophants in tarot, because the hierophants teach the secrets of the mysteries veiled in allegory, so the secular don't understand. And that's exactly what Tyson and Sagan seem to be doing. So we have all of these occultists, mystics, scientists, and Satanists agreeing and finding an equilibrium that whatever was happening during that 1,000 years was bad, and that
we must not let it happen again.
Now let me ask you this. Who do you think is really running the government and science industries behind the scenes? In secret, most of the elites are worshipping and being controlled by that hidden deity of the cosmos. Now, before we get into this last verse, I want to show one last significant synchronicity about the whole Knights Templar fiasco. The Templars were a secret society whose story still remains mysterious and strange. But to clear some things up on the Templars, there's two notions of them. There's a fake Templarism notion that the old world Christians were trying to take over, but in reality, they were the hardcore occultists, Johannite Gnostics, Talmudic Kabbalists, Essenes, etc., who were trying to infiltrate the Christendom in totality. And by the way, Blavatsky, Pike, and all the other cultists claimed that the Templars were the good guys. Now onto the strange synchronicities. In March 19, 1313, marks the date of Templar Grandmaster Jacques de Molay's execution according to Blavatsky and many others. Coincidentally, Pope Francis' papal conclave ceremony was March 13, 2013. And his inauguration was March 19, 2013. Could that have been some type of secret celebration of the Vatican / Knights Templar infiltration connection? And on top of that, 1313 marks 1,000 years after the legalization of Christianity in 313 AD. Not that I buy any of these dates as legit whatsoever, as you probably shouldn't either, but I'm just showing you how they work when writing these scripts. And from there forward, occult theology and Enlightenment period of Renaissance philosophies start to slowly become more common. Perhaps Satan was using the heretics during that time to set up for his full release later. Finally, on to the last verse.
And when the 1,000 years are ended, Satan will be released from his prison and will come out to deceive the nations that are at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea. And they marched up over the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. But fire came down from heaven and consumed them. And the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever.
I couldn't just leave out the ending, as if we were just stranded, hopeless, in a world under the dominion of the adversary. There will be a final judgment and chastisement of the earth. This reset isn't gonna be like a regular old reset we've seen in the old world. There won't be anywhere to hide. And paying some random YouTuber $400 for the survival guide won't save you, because this current state of earth will pass away, and only those in Christ, the Book of Life, will ascend to eternal life in paradise with God. Remember, God predestined humankind to be conformed to Christ. We are called to be holy and blameless before Him, sanctified and set apart from this world. things will get worse, but this will be a rescue, and those in Christ will not perish along with the rest of the world. In fact, according to Revelation 17 verse 8, the whole world, with the exception of the believers who are in the book of life, will be totally clueless during the time that Satan is loosed from the abyss. So it makes sense why everyone is scrambling and stressing trying to explain all these different old world phenomenons, but trying to do so while leaving out the most important thing, God. This is literally all prophesied, and we've just been reading the Bible on the wrong chronological timeline. And God was gracious enough to reveal this huge deception. Jesus did say the deceptions will be so great, even the elect would be fooled if possible. How blessed are we to even have a hint of an understanding of this? But for the saints in Christ, we literally have nothing to worry about because God knows what he's doing, and his divine plan, like it's always been, will be worked out. God's gonna work it out. I tell you, God's gonna work it out.